Good morning, afternoon, evening, global community. We're here today at with Frontline Defenders to talk about women human rights defenders in militarized zones and to speak with them so we can learn their tactics and their strategies for dealing in militarized zones. And really fortunate to have Raja Atali from the Center for Civil Society and Democracy in Syria with us right now. So if you can, I'd like you to do a little bit of an intro and we can jump into some questions.
Hi. Thank you so much, Mehta, for the introduction. So my name is Raja Atali. I'm co-director for Center for Civil Society and Democracy, and I would like to give like a little of background on the work that we are doing. So mainly as a Syrian organization who support and strengthen civil society and promote democracy and promote the human rights value in Syria, which is very challenging given circumstances at the moment. So within Syria now there are different parts of Syria and there are different kind of controlled forces, where some area is under the control of the Syrian regime, others are under the control of the armed groups, and some area are under PYD, and other area under ISIS controlled area. So within different places and different controlled armed group or controlled forces, controlling forces, human rights defenders are working on finding all time, continuously different tactics in order to be able to keep mobilizing people, keep defending human rights value and defending the activists who are really suffered a lot from the human rights violations.
So,
So mainly, yeah, go ahead, sorry.
I just want to take a step back so we can set the context of what would you say you mean by militarization in Syria, in your country, and given all these different zones that militarized groups are operating in?
Yeah, so it's very important when we are talking on the Syrian context to talk about before 2011, during 2011, and after 2011. So if I want to divide it into three stages. So before 2011, a human rights was suffering a lot from the Syrian regime, where really there was kind of, we called it fake stability and fake security situation, because if anyone who expressed his or her political views or any type of really movement or forming associations or political party, that they are under the risk of arrest, torture, also death. Many cases was reported. So you have documentation for people who were arrested and tortured badly. It's there. In 2011, people and the human rights activists who really mobilized to protest in the street for more freedom of mobilization, freedom of gathering, for the main value for freedom, justice, and coexistence in Syria, then the Syrian regime response was very harsh on people, and many people were shot at in the street and they were killed. Many thousands of people were arrested. Maybe 10,000, tens of thousands of people were arrested, if not more. And Until now, that like many people are missing, we don't know their destination, their like situation where they are. And until now, like the threat of arrest, it's all the time is there with the Syrian regime. But you know, after 2011 and in the beginning of 2012, there was like the beginning of the militarized revolution. And like many people pick up arms in order to respond to the aggressiveness by the Syrian regime. And then, like as I said, like you have different controlling places who are the like the armed groups now. They are also committing human rights violation, where like also human rights defenders are trying hard to stand against it, but also it's very hard, and there's a lot of arrest as well with armed group and also tortured.
So I want to actually bring in Wei Wei Nu from Burma, Myanmar, to first of all intro yourself and then also talk to us about what militarization means for you in the context of your country and your community. Hello? Can you hear me? Oh, great. Yes.
First of all, thank you so much. Can you hear me?
Yes, perfectly.
Can you hear me? Okay, great. So first of all, thank you so much. Thanks for this opportunity to talk, to discuss in this platform. I think in our context in Burma, Myanmar, we have experience of military government for more than several decades, for more than 6 decades. So the country and the system is highly militarized. Because of this military system dictatorship, we have like several conflict, armed conflict and unarmed conflict throughout the country, particularly in the borders. In the borders, particularly where ethnic and religious minorities are living. So since I belong to a minority called Rohingya, which is not recognized by the state, and also many other minorities like me, what we have experienced in our country is when since we grown up, we just afraid of we just have like full of fear of when we even look at the military. And whoever in the in power, whoever kind of security forces, whoever with arm, so it's the country in a country, the security forces and armed groups, I mean arms, the security forces, the military, they're supposed to be protecting people. But what we feel whenever we see them, we just feel scared. So that's our experience. And because we just whenever we saw them, we met them, they always kind of what we said, they threaten people, they abuse people, they kill people, they arrest people. I mean, there is no justice and total impunity that the militarized people, the military and security forces are getting, continuing their impunity for their perpetration is increase the fear among the people, and it's a threat to the people who are living in the conflict areas, and that's the daily life of the people who are living in the conflict area in Myanmar.
So let's add another component to this conversation on militarization. What does gender do when we add that to the equation? How does it change the effects of militarization? Is it stronger for women? Does it operate differently when its militarization is directed towards women?
Yeah, so whenever we have militarizations, the always gender, particularly women, are victimized. Women are targeted. Women are targeted to fulfill their interests, or as a way to fulfill to make vulnerable or vulnerability among the community, women are being used. And on the again, it's mainly the armed groups and security forces, the military, are mainly dominated by the men, and they don't understand what's going on with the women, and they don't understand the fear of women and the security of women, and the how to respect women and how to take seriously women as a human being. So whenever there is militarization, the women are one of the most targeted the sector for them, the community for them. And I think, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, that's better.
So so from our understanding, the women are one of the most targeted community in militarized society, and they are they have affected stronger than the other community, mainly women and children, because the militarized community, whether from the authority sides or from the rebel sides, opposite sides, it's always men. So women have lost their voice when there is armed conflict, when there is conflict, when there is securities are full of arms, security forces, police, and all these things, all the sectors are full of arms among their environment, and they have lost their voice. I think that is very important. We put women in the security sectors as well, and we increase the gender perspective and the human rights educations and the militarized society. It's important.
So I want to throw the question back at Raja about how militarization might be gendered in Syria. If you could give us some of those details, that would be great.
So if we look to the how the society look to the see the impact that any events happen with women in Syria affected her and her family more, because people see women are the owner of the family. Then I can give some example about when the woman is arrested, then the whole issue of torture, getting raped, etc., makes much harder on women than men. For example, when an activist who is arrested, if it's a man, it's an honor. Sometimes they are defending human rights violation, and they are defending human rights, etc., while woman, it's considered in the eyes of the society as a shame that they are arrested. The family, sometimes they wanted to hide it, they don't want to announce it. And then when the woman detainees or the female detainees are released, sometimes it will be harder on her in order to really be able to be included in the society because of this fear of making shame for the whole family, etc. So this is one example. The second example, whenever you have Islamic armed group or even sometimes moderate armed group, that freedom of movement, it's much harder on women than men, getting through checkpoints, Also, like being able to move by yourself, etc., it's getting harder and harder. In Syria, I mean, this is needless to speak about the area where ISIS is controlling, where woman is not able to have the freedom of choosing what she would wear, etc. But also, she is not able to move it, like to walk in the street by herself. She needs always like a male male person to accompany her in her movement. So this all shows you the effect that the militarization and the situation in general, which is heavily militarized in Syria, how they are affecting the women movement. Like in like with giving those examples, I really want to show my respect and to all the women in Syria who are, despite all these challenges and like risk, big risk that they are taking, they are still very active, especially like in doing a lot of activity regarding like negotiating humanitarian aid access. So maybe like in the last 3 months, the situation in Zabadani was like really getting worse and worse, and then the Zabadani woman launched like Zabadani Woman Initiative to stop the violence, and in Madaya, where it's a besieged area, women are playing a big role in really like mobilizing people to to ask for breaking the siege on Madaya, and it's getting to the point that people are dying from hunger basically, and women playing big role in that. And this is like an example from the south, an example from the north. Like you have like many women either like in Idlib, Aleppo, Hama, Latakia, they are playing like a big role in raising awareness and education, which is really like a difficult, the education is suffered a lot in the 5 years in Syria, and like women are playing a big role in that and making sure that at least minimum level of education still, or like children are getting like minimum level of education, even if it's not formal. And also like in eastern area, like in Kurdish ruled area by BYD, and it's also women are playing like big role, especially like in fighting corruption, raising awareness about transparency, etc.
So Raja, you did a great job in setting the context for us and then kind of going over how women have strategized in responding to the militarization in these different geographies. I wondered if you could go a little bit deeper in terms of especially the different geographies of militarization, like you were talking about in ISIS or Daesh held areas and military dominant and Syrian regime military dominant areas and other zones. How do women or people within your organization, what sort of tactics have you developed to help women respond to the militarization? And then Weiwei, I would love for you to also go into that as well, so we can get into the details and the nitty gritty of what it's like day in and day out.
Yeah, so I mean, also I'm very proud of women and men who are still like doing great job on the ground in Syria, that it's not only they are inventing tactics all the time, they are able like really to like to find new solution, like the flexibility that they are working in, like in a very difficult circumstances, it's amaze me all the time. Like, so I can give you example on like from Saraqib, like one of my colleagues who was like conducting like workshops, especially with like group of women, where you know like Saraqib and Idlib in general, it's like under a lot of airstrikes, and you would think that like people wouldn't do any activity in these circumstances, but you know like they are trying to move from one place place to another in order to see where's the less like security threatening circumstances that they can work in. They work sometimes in the basement, of course, like some of the tactics, like especially in the regime held area, that like you don't use your name at all, you include some of the messages that you want to work on within like other type of work. You try to work in a very secretive way, that like closed area, closed group of people are the one who knows the work that you are doing, and through like forming different closed group, you are able to work and mobilize a little bit. In the regime held area also, like the lawyers are playing a big role and like tapping within the role that lawyers are doing is very essential. Also like in ISIS controlled area, sometimes like women are playing big role especially raising awareness about like early and forced marriage, like the threats and also the consequences from early and forced marriage. And it's like a big effort regarding that. And in even like in the area where like you think like it's stable kind of, for example in Afrin just like a couple of days ago, there was like arrest of from BYD for around 20 actually activists who are working on a humanitarian organizations. So there's like a big movement from the ground to mobilize in order to release them as well. So this is, I mean, from like a very risky situation, like where there's like air strikes like by Russia and also by the Syrian regime, but in the same time, like just how like you move from one place to another, you analyze the situation, and this is all like tools and skills and tactics that like the women and men on the ground, they are trying to implement all the time or use all the time.
That was very great and excellent and thorough. And Weiwei, I would love to get your comments and your feedback on the tactics and strategies that you and your community have used to respond to this gendered militarization and just militarization in general.
Thanks, Roger. It's really useful and informative. Thank you so much for your discussion. I think when you talk about the militarized society and militarizations and conflict and armed conflict, one of the most serious issue is for the women, and being a woman, is the lack of security. Always women security are not the ensure. As I said, women can be targeted. One of the issues is women can be easily sexually abused, sexually targeted, face sexual harassment. So there are a lot of the things, a lot of the sexual harassment and abuses and rape are ongoing in Burma, in armed conflict areas and unarmed conflict areas like Rakhine State, Chin State, Shan State. So in this scenario, I think it is very important for the women, the community women are empowered, understand the situation and know what to do. In our case, there was in Kachin State, there was a rape case a few months back, a rape case of community women who are the nurses and community leaders of the community, the conflict area at the IDP camps, and they were raped by the military. But still yet the reality and the case was not taken to the accountable. So it is that's the reality. It's really challenging for the women to get justice and accountability for these kinds of abuses if it is highly militarized. But however, it is always important for the women and to be aware and active and documented. So first of all, we have to know what's going on, and we have to have confidence to take that as an issue. And again, and it is very important to be confident, to have documentation. So we have to do documentations of every cases, and then we have to work on those cases. But it's not easy again to do documentations when it is the conflict is serious and the security, your security is not sure. So in these situations, I think it depends on the situations, your situations. For us, whatever documentations we do, it should be highly confidential, and we keep it highly confidential of what the work that we are doing, and the victims and the perpetrators, the case that that's happened in the.
Hello.
I'm sorry.
Okay, Liwei, can you hear me? Oh, I don't think we can hear you. I think this would be actually. There you are. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. So you were talking about documentation. I want to know if you can specifically, you had initially brought up empowering women. So what is done tactically to empower the women?
So it can be done in many ways. Yes. I mean, it can be done in many ways, particularly, you know, empowering women means, you know, how you would deal when you have the militarized community, militarized society, when you have conflict, to have trainings for the women and on to deal with the situations and to understand, including rehabilitations and the other trainings on like human rights situations, women's rights situations, women, peace and security, human rights trainings, I'm sorry, women's rights trainings, or even economic empowerment trainings like that. And also documentations, it can be everything, whatever, you know, just to feel them, they are useful, they know how to deal with, and they can do something. So that's important. And I think in our country, like the Kachin women, they are very much empowered now. They know what to do, and they document everything in the community what's happened, and they advocate with this evidence that they have, even though they are highly militarized society and they're highly risky, but they just take initiative. But it's depending on your situations. You have to be like, for example, as a Rohingya, we cannot organize anything in the brown. We cannot empower people or women. Visibly, we cannot. We cannot do trainings in the brown. But what we can do is we confidentially call documents the cases, and we advocate with these cases. We advocate with these cases, and hopefully, you know, when you, you can ask for the accountability through, you know, if we cannot go to the court, but you can do the indirect pressure to demilitarize the situations and to bring justice for those women in the community. Yeah.
Thank you for that, Weiwei. I also understand that you had, Weiwei has spent 7 years in prison. She was a political prisoner, which was an act of retaliation against her father's very politically active career. But before we go into that, I want to go back to Raja and talk about how we expand this out to the community of women human rights defenders. What do you want to share in terms of working in these militarized contexts? So I know there are things that we talked about that were very specific to your context. What can be taken to a universal level and implemented globally?
So when you look to the Syria from outside, like you always think, even sometimes from inside, that it's too complicated, it's too many actors are involved, like it's not understandable. And then like the easier is like to look aside and see like how things are developed. So I feel like it's very important all the time to remember that there are local women, like local Syrian women, local Syrian change actors who are really working hard and try all the time to find like local solutions to problems that they are identifying and how to really manage their way in an extremely difficult situations like air bombing, airstrikes, ISIS prisons, checkpoints, hunger, being in a besieged area, there's no medical facility, there's no education, etc. With all these circumstances, people are trying very hard, like many local people are working hard in order to find the local solutions. So basically, it's important to just like with like more direct like look and support for the human rights defenders, Syrian human rights defenders and Syrian women who are really the actors for change in Syria. So that's it.
That's probably really interesting, as you're based in Turkey right now and doing some of the work with the locals. And looking from the inside out, I can imagine how it's gives you a lot of hope, but it must be very sort of frustrating to be on the outside. Wei, same question. What do you think you could tell women human rights defenders outside of Burma? What have you learned? What would you suggest that they think about tactically?
Yeah, I think as a human rights defender, it is very important for us to be confident, and that confidence can be gained by learning, by sharing each other, by making coalition network, and when you have your environment, when you have more supporters and you feel more confidence, when you have more knowledge on the work that you are doing. And the related the knowledge and skill that you are related to your work, and you have more confidence. Particularly, we have to understand the domestic laws and international laws related to the women's and women rights. We have to like by heart the CEDAW. We have to by heart. We have to know what's going on at the UN level. You have to know what is the Women, Peace and Security Resolution. That means we have to know what we have in our hand and what we can hold to make accountable for the perpetrators, and also not always just being as a woman. I mean, within the women's group, but also, you have to make like alliance in the supporters, in the other civil society actors, the LGBT rights actors and others, child rights actors, whoever it is, then that's, we have to support each other. And we have to include more women in our movement, more men in the movement. And more supporters, more men voice, and that became more your voice became more stronger, I think that's building confidence. After all, it's very important, and building knowledge and skills, and you know, and helping each other. And I think yes, and also one of the most important thing important things I believe is, you know, women's we have to show our feminist behavior, and we have to be always stick on the nonviolence activities and nonviolence actions. We are seeing that there are some women who are joining to the militarized groups, so that's not a good sign for the women history and women's movement. And as I believe in nonviolence actions, I think it is important you build your power with nonviolent actions, and you try to solve the situations, improve the status of women and the rights of the women under the nonviolent actions. That's very important, and we have legitimate voice at that time. If you are nonviolent, and also, you know, it is very important you understand the situations and the conditions of your country and your conflict and your situation. Then you know how to work effectively without harm yourself. Otherwise, you can be in danger anytime. I think for me, I mean, sometimes, you know, being vocal is effective, but we have to know that how we are going to be vocal, in what way. So if we cannot be vocal in the right way, then we can be in danger. For me, the most concerning thing is I don't want to be in danger, because I have to continue our work. That's how we can change the condition. So if you are not exist, if you are in danger, if you are in trouble, if you cannot continue your work, we lose the human resources to change the condition. So, you know, for the sake of continuations of your struggle until you end on the conditions, it is very important that you are secure yourself and you try to secure the other women's, fellow women's in the society.
So, Weiwei, you brought up a really interesting question that I would love to pose. Not that it's interesting because I came up with it, but you just really triggered this question I had, which was, you talked about the intersection of being vocal, but also balancing it with the knowledge that there's a threat to being vocal, that it could be dangerous. So given that, I was wondering for both of you, and we'll go with Raja first, why do you continue? And how do you continue? How do you persevere? How do you continue on your struggle in these militarized conflicts when you're facing armies, heavily funded armies, when you're facing different armed groups and the violence is especially mounted against women? How do you continue? What makes you continue? What makes you hopeful?
You know, yeah, so I am in Turkey, not inside Syria. I think like it's very interesting to have like answers from people who are really under like bombing or like under the threat of like arrest or like they are not able to move. So it's much easier for me to say than like others, but it's also hard. Like even when you are in Turkey and when you are like networking and like coordinating with many people on the ground, like it's very hard to continue, because like it's, you know that you have some colleagues who are under siege, you know that like you are talking with them, like maybe like I was talking with like one of the women that we worked with before, with Women for the Future of Syria, and she like we were trying to get some story out like to the world, like how people in Libya are like really dying because they don't have food, they don't have medical assistance, and And we were like trying to get like one picture from her, and she was like almost crying, saying like, we are trying to do our best, we are tired. And when she said we are tired, I feel like, you know, like it gives you like the feeling for 1 second that like it's enough, like all the like her stories in Syria should stop immediately. You need to have ceasefire, you need to have like really like type of normal life. But in the same time, like ironically, it gives you a lot of strength in order to be able to continue, because you feel like people who are really in a very hard circumstances, like they are continuing and they are finding solutions. So it's like they give me the strength and they give me the momentum in order to continue.
Yeah, yeah, wow. I kind of got chills when you were talking about the woman saying that she's tired. Wei Wei, I did mention that you spent 7 years in prison, and you were talking about that balance of being vocal and possibly your vocality putting you in danger, and knowing that you had been in prison, how do you continue? How do you persevere?
Yeah, I think when I was in prison, in my young age, teenage, I feel like I understood that was injustice, and I don't want to happen to other women and other youth in my country, and I mean to prevent this kind of injustice happen to other youth and women, and the only way I can do is I just need to discover this this injustice, and I just need to talk about this, and also as it is injustice, and for me, I think I cannot accept injustice to anyone. So just being intolerant on the injustice give me a lot of strength, knowing that and not accepting that situation, and that gives me finding the reality and justice. That is the driving and factor of my activism. And when you know more and more injustice happening in your environment, and then you cannot stop it. And for me, until we get justice, I will not stop it. So it will be hard sometime. I know that I can be arrested anytime. I can be in danger anytime, I can be attacked anytime, but if you don't do, then who else will do? I mean, every struggle should start from individually. So everyone should take their own responsibility. And for me, it's more responsibility. I perceive myself as, you know, taking responsibility for the society, for your community, and for your country, or for humanity, you know, for human beings. So if you accept injustice for one case or for others, and you are supporting for other kind of injustice as well. So I just don't like injustice, and I just want to take responsibility for the community and for the women's in our community. I don't know, there are lots of factors, you know, that drive me, but it's more your individual responsibility and in tolerant responding on the injustice.
Thank you both to Raja and Wei Wei, very incredibly inspiring women. I don't know, honestly, how you do it living in militarized zones, being stateless people, having been locked up before, and continuing to hear the stories on the ground every day, and dealing with a global community that is either invested in geopolitical economic gain or is apathetic. So I really, really, my heart goes out to you. We were also going to have,
Yeah, I think, you know, if you accept the injustice, if you accept the discriminations, if you accept the militarization, at the end you can be just gone. You can be just, so in our case, the community that we are the Rohingya, they used to be ethnic indigenous people of Burma, one of the ethnic indigenous people. Now they became as stateless because they don't have any document in their hand anymore. The authorities taken anything. So I feel like that's happened because in the past, in our older generation, they didn't take their individual responsibility while they're facing injustice and while they're losing their rights. Their rights, they just accept it. So in our case, I mean, whether it's from the women, from the side of women, or as a community, I think we shouldn't be tolerant on any kind of injustice. That's how we can protect our rights and our existence and we can promote our status.
Yeah, so the work is not just important, it's necessary. Part of this conversation, we were going to have women, human rights defenders from Ukraine and Egypt, but we had some internet issues with them. This is, of course, another testament to why we need to build connections between women, human rights defenders, because, you know, sometimes the internet doesn't help us out. But I'm very, very thankful for the women we did have with us. Let me tell you about the women from Ukraine and Egypt that we were going to have on with us. Alexandra, and I'm so sorry for butchering your last name, Alexandra Matvichuk. She's the president of the Kiev-based Center for the Civil Liberties and coordinator of the Euromaidan SOS, which was created after the violent crackdown of peaceful demonstrations in Independence Square in 2013. So please do look into her work. And then from Egypt, Yara Salam, who is a feminist and a woman human rights defender, who has worked as a lawyer and researcher for several Egyptian and international human rights organizations, including Egyptian Initiative for Personal Rights, Nazra for Feminist Studies, and the African Commission on Human and People's Rights. And she actually recently was released from prison in September 2015 for demonstrating with a group of people. I want to thank you, ladies, women, incredible human rights defenders in your own right, it doesn't even have to be gendered, for joining us in this conversation. And hopefully anybody listening, if you feel like you can support these women and the other women that I spoke about, do so, contact Frontline Defenders and find out how you can be involved and help these women. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Maitha, and human rights defenders all around the world need to be unified. Thank you.
Thank you.
Help protect human rights defenders on the front line. Contribute at www.frontlinedefenders.org/donate. Thank you.